Good morning. What a beautiful day to be in God's house this morning. Would you please join me in our call to worship? What shall we return to you, O God, for all of your bounty to us? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. O Lord, I am your servant, the child of your serving girl. You have loosed my bonds. I will give you thanksgiving and call on your name in the presence of all the people. Let us worship God. Gracious God, you shelter your people amid their distress. You provide them a haven of security and rest. You bring comfort to those with affliction and hear the pleas of the persecuted. You cause your mercy to flow like living water. Your benevolence stretches to the ends of the earth. We come in praise of all your goodness and lift our voices with thanks for your care. Shall we join in hymn number 724? Please join me in our litany of assurance. We boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace of God be with you. Greet one another in peace this morning.
think? We're going to find out.
Oh, wow. All right. Well, this, what are these things? Yeah, you know, one of the things dads do is they fix things, don't they? They fix things. And it's nice because I don't fix things very well. I don't know what to do with all these things. In fact, I don't know what they're for. So, dads fix things. That's cool. And you know what else dads do? Dads play ball with us, don't they? Yeah. Oh, good. Oh, I'm a lousy shot. Let's see. Sometimes they play basketball with us. That doesn't bounce very well. There. All right. Somebody catch that one. So, we don't have a ball for everybody, but we got a few. I am obviously a dangerous ball player, right? All right. Oh, here, there you go. And here's a couple more. Who else didn't get a ball? All right, who didn't get a ball? All right, anyway, I'm not safe with balls. So dads play with us, too. That's cool. It's fun to have dads play with us. Let's see. What's this? What is this? Money. Dads do things like they earn money for us, don't they? So we can pass out money to everybody, because dads do that. Oh, you're going to trade that in? All right. She wants money. That's okay. We have our priorities, and that's good. All right. So, another thing that dads do, I tried to bring a car in, but I couldn't fit one in through the gate. So dads take us places, don't they? They drive us around sometimes. And that, all right, you can have the car, but you can't keep all that money. You got to pass that out. You going to get a car? All right. There's a couple more cars. All right. Here we go. All right. So dads do all kinds of things for us. And you know what else dads do? What's this? A Bible. Dads are the head of our home, and they keep us on track with Jesus, don't they? They keep us on track with God. And you know, we talk about our dads here on earth, but we have a heavenly Father too, don't we? And the heavenly Father, we don't have to send him a card, do we? We don't send him a card, but we show him thanksgiving through the love that we give in our hearts every single day, don't we? Now, I'd like all the fathers out here to stand up. Can the dads stand up? Dads, stand up. All right. When you guys leave to go to Sunday school, I want you to go to each of these dads, and I want you to tell them, even if they're not your dad, I want you to tell them how much you appreciate the love and the support that each one of them give to you every day. Okay? Let's say a prayer. Jesus, thank you so much for loving us and for giving us our fathers, and thank you for our Heavenly Father. Amen. Be sure to go and say thank you to all these dads out here, okay? Thank you, dads. I appreciate it.
Jesus and His glory, our Jesus and His glory. Please be seated. The first scripture text today comes from Genesis chapter 18, starting at verse 1. The Lord appeared to Abraham at the oaks Mamre, as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked down and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them, and he bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I have found favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread, that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened to the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared, and he set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord?' At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. He said, "Oh, yes, you did laugh." Our New Testament lesson today comes from Romans chapter 5, starting at verse 1. "Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to his grace, in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely than now that we have been justified by his blood, we will be saved through him from the wrath of God." Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 35, chapter 9, starting at verse 35. "Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, for they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, 'The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord to send out laborers into the harvest.' Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles: first, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew; James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John; Philip and Bartholomew; Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector; James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus; Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, the one who would betray him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: 'Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You have received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for the laborer deserves his wages. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave the house or town. Truly I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on that day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep amidst the wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and to the Gentiles. When they have handed you over, do not worry about what you are to say or how you are to speak, for what you are to say will be given to you in that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and father his children. And the children will rise up against parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When Hannah was growing up, after she would go and visit a friend, she would come home and she'd be really energized, she'd be really excited, and she'd have to tell either myself or Melissa all about what she had done with this friend. Now, I have to admit today that I probably didn't listen to these conversations as closely as I should. There were a lot of words, and it was pretty fast, and it was hard to keep up. But one of the things I noticed on one such occasion is she claimed that this certain friend was her best friend. Now, I thought just a few days earlier, she'd claimed another friend was her best friend. But because I wasn't listening as closely as I should, I didn't ask her about it at that time, but I made a mental note of it. Sure enough, a couple days later, she came back. She was talking about all the things she had done with this other friend, and she went on, and then she called this friend her best friend. So I stopped her. I said, "Now, Hannah, you said this person is your best friend. A couple days ago, you said this other person was your best friend." And she looked at me without skipping a beat and said, "Well, this is my other best friend." She was younger, about preschool age. Best friend was plural for Hannah. And after 25 years of ministry, I realized that there is a little bit of Hannah in me as well. For 25 years, I've been preaching according to the common lectionary, and it gives you scriptures for each Sunday. And each Sunday that I, or each week that I start to look at these scriptures, I find one of the stories in them and I go, "Ooh, this is one of my favorite stories." And then the next week, certainly in 2 weeks, I'm reading the scriptures again and go, "Ooh, this is one of my favorite stories." Seems that my definition of favorite Bible story is plural as well. Having said that, our Old Testament lesson is one of my favorite stories. It is one of my favorite stories for a number of reasons. First, we have God appearing to Abraham in a very unusual way, almost in bodily form. Three individuals come to Abraham, and he recognizes one of them as God. Now, in the Old Testament, oftentimes when an angel would come to an individual and talk with them, that person, that angel, would be recognized as God, as a proxy for God. And so it's possible that these are three angels. But as we go through our Old Testament lesson today and continue with the scripture, it is clear one of these is not an angel, but actually God. And so God is appearing to Abraham almost in bodily form here. In the same way that Abraham gets to speak face to face with God here, later Moses will and Elijah. So one of the first things I love about this lesson is the unique, the strange way that God appears to Abraham. And Abraham is so thankful that God has visited him. He does what he can, and that is he prepares a feast. He does what he knows according to his day is the right thing, the social customs. You feed a visitor. So he sets up a big meal. And then as they're eating this meal, God tells Abraham, "I'm going to return to you in a year, and Sarah will have a son." Now, Sarah's listening at the tent door. why not? She wants to know what's going on. And when she hears in a year that she's going to have a son, she laughs. And then she starts thinking to herself, how in the world could such a thing be possible? It's understandable that Sarah laughed because she was about 90 years old and her husband was about 100 years old. It's understandable that she laughed and questioned, how in the world is this going to happen? We can sit down today or any day, and if we read through Scripture, we can see that there are several times that God miraculously intervenes in a human conception. We have the angel appearing to Samson's mother and father, telling them that they will have a very special child who will start to deliver Israel from the Philistines, and that indeed happened. We have Hannah, who goes up to the sanctuary because she hasn't been able to bear a child, and she's pouring out her soul to God and praying, and she gets the blessing of Eli, the high priest, to conceive, and so she conceives with her husband, and Samuel is born, the last of the judges, one of the greatest of the prophets, and the individual who will usher in the kingdoms of Israel. And of course, we have the story of Elizabeth in the New Testament, who is past the childbearing years. And her husband Zechariah is told by the archangel Gabriel that he will conceive with his wife a son. And that indeed happens, and his name becomes known as John the Baptist. And then, of course, we have Mary conceiving immaculately in the New Testament. As we look at Scripture, we can see there are many times where God has miraculously intervened in human conception. But Sarah knew none of those stories because they were all after her. And we have no stories in Scripture prior to Sarah where God miraculously intervenes in a conception. If there is, they didn't write them down. And one thing's for sure, if there were, Sarah didn't know about them. So it's no wonder that Sarah laughed when she thought about this promise that God had given Abraham 25 years before this, that if Abraham followed him, that he and Sarah would have a son. One of the reasons I love this gospel lesson, because Sarah has this honest human reaction, which is laughter. How in the world is this going to happen? But of course, God speaking to Abraham and through Abraham to Sarah, as he knows she's listening, says, is anything too wonderful for God? And then he asks Abraham, why did Sarah laugh? And when Sarah realizes, of course, that God knows exactly what she has done, she gets afraid. She starts saying, no, I didn't laugh. And then finally, God speaks directly to Sarah and says, no, you did laugh. The third reason I love our Old Testament lesson is, why did God insist on telling Sarah that she laughed? Was it because God was angry at her? Was it because God wanted to judge her? Was it because she was in trouble? No. God insisted for none of those reasons. Instead, it was for her own good. God was calling to her remembrance all the wonderful things that God had done for her and Abraham over the 25 years that they had walked with God. God was calling to her remembrance that God can do a wonderful and amazing things. God was pleading with her, just continue to have faith. Just continue to have hope. And what you want is indeed going to happen. And of course, the final reason I love this story is because it did happen. Abraham and Sarah conceived a child, and they named him Isaac, which is laughter, or those who will hear will laugh. And it's such an amazing ending to such a wonderful story. In our gospel lesson today, Jesus calls the 12, and then he sends them two by two out to preach the good news of the gospel. And through the Holy Spirit, he endows them with incredible powers. He says, heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out the evil spirits, cleanse the lepers. He gives them amazing, incredible powers by the Holy Spirit as he sends them out two by two to proclaim the good news of the gospel, that the kingdom is here. After giving them the Holy Spirit, then Jesus also gives them a few words of wisdom. One of the first things Jesus tells them is that, let the peace of God be with you. Claim the peace of God that God wants for you through the Holy Spirit, so that when you go out in the world, you can share that peace. You can share it with individuals. You can share it with groups. The first thing Jesus reminds them is take hold of the Holy Spirit and the peace that God wants you to have through the Holy Spirit. Now, this is a very different peace than the kind of peace we hear about today. This is not a peace among nations or peoples or groups, as important as that is. This is the peace that God gives to an individual through the Holy Spirit. And Jesus says, you need to have this as you're going out in the world. And then he tells them something else. He says, after you've claimed this peace and you're talking to other people and trying to share this peace with them, Jesus says, if they don't share your peace, don't let that rob you of the peace that God wants you to have. He says, as you're going out in peace, don't let others' rejection of what you're trying to do rob you of the peace that God wants to give you in the Holy Spirit. Then Jesus tells them, after reminding them to claim the peace that there is theirs by God through the Holy Spirit, he tells them, I want you to go out because I'm sending you out as sheep among the wolves, and I want you to be as wise as serpents, but as innocent as doves. What in the world is Jesus referring to when he asked them to be wise as serpents? Well, Jesus wanted them, to put it bluntly, not to be stupid about doing the will of God. There were all kinds of examples in Jesus' day of individuals who did all that they could. They used their intelligence, they used their imagination, they used their dedication, their hard work, their perseverance to accomplish things in life. There were so many examples in Jesus' day. You had the athletes who competed in the games. You had the politicians who were vying for power. You had individuals in the military who were trying to work their way up to positions of authority. You had the religious leaders in Jesus' day who were all vying for power and supremacy. The world of Jesus was filled with examples of individuals who had goals and aspirations and used all their intelligence, imagination, hard work, desire, and perseverance to achieve those things. And Jesus is saying, I want you to do the same thing about the will of God. Use all of your imagination. Use your intelligence. Use your perseverance. Use your endurance. Use all these things to accomplish the will of God. Just as you see other people in the world working hard to attain goals, do so for the kingdom of God. And then after telling them that they need to be like other people in the way they go about achieving goals, then he tells them, but you're supposed to be different. You're supposed to be wise as serpents. You're supposed to marshal all that you can to do the will of God. But then you must be innocent as doves. And what is he talking about here? Well, he's telling the apostles that if in performing the will of God, you find yourself in a position of authority or power, then you need not to be like everybody else. The world was full of examples of individuals who'd worked their way up to positions of power. And then when they had that power, what did they do it? They wielded it for their own gain. They wielded it for what they wanted. They wielded it for the benefit of those close to them, the ones they loved. And they didn't really care about anybody else. Jesus is saying, you're not to be like that. If you have any authority, if you have any power, remember who gave you that power. Remember the purpose of that power. Remember what you're supposed to do with it. This was a very important lesson that Jesus gave the apostles, not just once, but constantly throughout the days that he walked with them, and even after he rose from the dead. Why? Because God was going to endow these apostles with amazing powers. And not just hundreds, and not just thousands, and not just tens of thousands would one day look up to them after Jesus' death and resurrection and after the day of Pentecost. They would have power. People would listen to them. And so Jesus was reminding them, as you go out and apply all that you have to do the will of God, if you have a position of power, authority, remember where you got that power and what the purpose of that power is and what you're supposed to do with that power. Be as wise as serpents in doing the will of God, but as innocent as doves in your dealing with other people. Then finally, Jesus tells them something very important. He says, when you go out and you perform the will of God, he says, don't be surprised if you suffer for it. And he goes on at length to tell them about how they are going to suffer even though they're doing the right thing. So when they start suffering, they're not supposed to sit there and think, well, is God angry at me or am I not doing the right thing? Because Jesus says, that's not what the suffering is all about. In our gospel lesson today, Jesus not only gifts the apostles with the Holy Spirit, but then he gives them words of wisdom as they go out and try to perform the will of God in their lives. We've been talking a lot the last couple of weeks about how we're all called just as the apostles were. And we've been talking a lot the last couple of weeks how we have been given the Holy Spirit just as the apostles were in our gospel lesson and on the day of Pentecost. God calls us to go out in the world and to work the will of God. God gifts us the Holy Spirit, but he also gives us some words of wisdom so that we can remember them as we go out in the world. And one of the first things Jesus reminds us is that if we're going to go out in the world and work the will of God, we've got to claim that peace that God wants us to have through the Holy Spirit. We have to claim that peace, because only after claiming that peace that God wants us to have through the Holy Spirit can we share it with other people. Can we share it with the groups and organizations we are a part of? We have to first claim that peace given to us by God. Then we can share it with the world. And Jesus tells us very wisely, if we're trying to share it and individuals or groups don't want to share in our peace, that's okay. Let our peace return to us. Don't lose our own peace because someone else won't enjoy that peace that God wants them to have. Jesus also tells us that we need to be wise as serpent and innocent as doves as we go out in the world. And that is, we need to use everything we have to accomplish the will of God. We need to use our imagination and intelligence. We need to use our hard work and dedication. We need to use our perseverance. The will of God doesn't just happen. It is something that we have to apply ourselves towards, just like any goal. Just like anything that we would value in the world, that we would work for, so too we're supposed to work, use all that we have to accomplish the will of God. But then having accomplished it, or in the process of accomplishing it, Jesus reminds us we always need to be aware, anytime we have any position of power or authority over an individual, why did God give us that power? What's the purpose of God giving us that power? How does the Holy Spirit want us to use that power? Finally, Jesus tells us that we ought not to be surprised if we go out in the world and in doing the will of God, we suffer. It's not a sign that God is angry with us. It's not a sign that God is upset with us. It's not a sign that God is trying to get back at us for something. It is simply part of the walk of discipleship. As Jesus suffered, as the apostles suffered, as countless Christians have suffered down throughout the centuries, we will at times suffer for the will of God. Don't be surprised about that. And then finally, our Old Testament lesson reminds us of something we always need to be aware of. And that is the wonderful and amazing and incredible things that God can do. Even in our lives, each day, God has the possibility to do amazing and wonderful and incredible things in our life. All we have to do is open ourselves up to those possibilities. All we have to do is call to remembrance all that God has done throughout the histories, throughout the ages, to individuals, to men and women of faith. All we have to do is remember we have a God that can do wonderful and amazing things as we're going out in the world seeking to manifest the will of God. Be open to the possibilities, because you never know, as Sarah herself didn't, what God is going to do. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for your words of wisdom, and we pray that by your Spirit you will lead us in the way of discipleship. Pray all this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Please join me in the affirmation of faith in your bulletin, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. The flowers on the communion table today are in honor of Virginia Blair's 95th birthday. So where is Virginia? Oh, there she is. Yes. We're going to sing Happy Birthday to Virginia. Any other announcements anyone has? Yes, Amy.
Okay, so a week from tomorrow is vacation Bible school. So first off, pray that the weather is not like this for a whole week with 100 and some children in a church. That probably won't work out that well. So please pray for warm weather. We are already up to 75 children in VBS, and if you donated any items for me sitting out front, if you could have them here by Friday so we know what we need to go purchase. Also, if you are available on Friday, there will be some of us here decorating the church Friday at 10:30 if you're available to come and help. And I went through our little name tags that the children wear all week, and after many years of use, some of our lanyards are, well, not very nice looking. So if anybody has lanyards or something like this at home that it doesn't matter what they say on them, if you could drop them off, we just need some extras in case we don't have enough. And then I was given this job, I don't know how, but here's a Happy Father's Day gift for the men in the choir.
I'd just like to add, as you're praying for it to be good weather for VBS, don't pray for it to be too hot. That would be bad as well. Any other announcements? Any prayer requests?
Oh. Are they out there? Did we put them out there?
In a couple weeks, we're going to be having a congregational meeting on the bylaws of this church. It comes out of a joint venture between session and trustees. We printed them out. I'm not sure if they're out there or not, but we have a few weeks. So if they're not out there this week, we will put them out next week. Do we have them? Okay, yeah, they'll be out there. So if you're interested in the change of the bylaws, pick one up. The meeting is going to be actually on July 9th. So please, if you're interested in that, be here on July 9th. Any other announcements? Okay, then. Any prayer requests? Yes.
Bob.
Vanessa. Okay, let's gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we are thankful that because you have called us, because you have justified us, and you have sanctified us in the Holy Spirit, we always have the opportunity to come before you. You promise that you will always listen. Listen to our emotions and our thoughts. Listen to our struggles and our doubts. Listen to our praises and our thanksgivings. We thank you for this wonderful opportunity to come before you and to share what is important to us. We pray, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit will indeed rest upon us. Rest upon us in the ways that you have promised. Promised because of what you did for us. That you're always there, your presence, your spirit, to help us to manifest your will in the world. We also thank you, Lord God, for your words and the words of the apostles and others who have written and spoken and talked about the things that we need to remember as we're seeking to serve you in the world. We thank you for this incredible cloud of witness to help us, to enable us, and to compel us to do your will. We also pray this day, Lord God, for all those who are grieving, all those who have lost family members, all those who have been touched by tragedies that we hear about on the news. We pray, Lord God, that your presence will be with these individuals in a very special way. Pray especially this day for Ron and for Vanessa. Now let's take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord God, thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication found in your bulletin. You urge us to travel lightly and proclaim your peace. Relieve us of whatever hinders our mission and give to us sustenance for the journey. The gifts we offer are symbols of our commitment. By whatever peace we foster, help us to heal antagonisms that divide your people. And may our actions provide hospitality, even in the midst of hospitality. Amen. You'll notice in your bulletin that our benediction is a communal benediction today. Please join with me in the benediction. Wherever you go, God is sending you. Wherever you are, God has put you there. He has a purpose in your being there. Christ, who indwells you, has something he wants to do through you where you are. Believe this and go in his grace and love and power. Amen.